Father John and to this parish. It's a lovely honour to come and share with you in this lovely occasion of the Novena. I think it's a beautiful concept of people coming as a community of faith to share the prayers and concerns that are on their hearts and to do it as the people of faith, to join together in prayer but also in someone's journey of life. So thank you for the opportunity to come and speak. I'm from the north, and so if I start to go too fast, you have the freedom to put your hand up, and I will know that means slow down. I was saying to my wife, did you ever believe in your wildest dreams that I would be president of the Methodist Church in Ireland? I, you know, just an ordinary guy from East Belfast who struggled through school, who rarely got into any sporting teams, although loved his sport. A gentleman, a guy with dyslexia, who made his way a little bit in the commercial world, but generally was just an ordinary guy. I said, Leslie, in your wildest dreams, did you ever imagine me being president of the Methodist Church? She turned to me and looked and said, Brian, you're really in my wildest dreams. My heart is to be a pastor and to walk alongside those people who find themselves on the margins of society. It seems to me, as I look at the gospel messages and the gospel stories told to us by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it was the religious people who didn't get Jesus. He was constantly having to justify himself again and again before them. But it was the people on the margins of society, the blind, the lame, the poor, the Zacchaeus of this world, who were the people who flocked to him. And he engaged with them. He seemed to understand them better than the religious people of the day did. There's a challenge for us in that. I am encouraging Methodists up and down our island home to be aliens, take it from 1 Peter, in a strange land. To live as holy people and bring the love of Jesus Christ to whatever situation you find yourself in. At home, at work, through church, wherever it may be. And to be different. And the difference that I'm encouraging Methodists to have is when you be people who just love the individual. I love the fact that as Zacchaeus climbed up the tree, this little small guy, who probably had all kinds of names thrown at him, Shorty, you're a cheat, you've stolen, you've taken all kinds of things from us. And yet Jesus looks up the tree and he says, Zacchaeus. He knew his name. And I find that increasingly beautiful. Jesus knows your name. You are known by the Lord. I just find that mind-blowing. I remember being on the top of a double-decker bus in Oxford Street in London and just seeing the mass of people running around, busy, busy bees. And sensing the Lord say to me, and I know him, and I know her, and I know this one, and I know that one. And that's the Lord to whom we bring our prayers to. That's the one who hears our cry. So my ministry has been within the church, of course, but also to those on the margins and those who have found it difficult. Father John said about Horizons when I was minister in Lisburn, in County Down. There was a number of young girls, young teenage girls, who took their life to suicide. Most of the two in particular were from the riding community. My daughter anger or anger, she'll jump. And so they asked me, as the only clergy person they know, would I participate and look after the funerals? And it was haunting. The impact of a suicide, it's like dropping a stone in a pond, and the ripples just go further and further out, from the family to the community, to the peers, to those who have thought about it themselves. I remember Paula, successful. Her and Stevie Boy won every competition. If Stevie Boy and Paula were in the competition, the best that she could hope for was second. She was that good. She had a lovely boyfriend. Life was good. And yet many of us believe just in a moment of madness. Because there's no letter left or no reason to understand why Paula took her life. Everybody was devastated. Of course she couldn't imagine. And talking to her dad and a couple of other friends afterwards, I asked the question, do you think there is a culture of suicide amongst our teenagers in Lisburn? And so I wrote a few articles in the local press, and the feedback that came back was significant. So much so that I said, okay, we need to do something. And so we gathered a group of people together and we formed Horizons. We took the title from the sense of the horizon, and when your head is down and you've lost someone you've loved, to lift your head to face a new horizon was the image that we tried to create. And it's still going. Sadly, it's needed, but families are supported by it. I believe passionately that's what the Church of Jesus Christ should be. Methodists, our founder is a man called John Wesley, and we have many straplines, but one I would like you just to remember is this. We are friends of all and enemies of none. So we seek to be people who bring reconciliation and love to situations. In many ways, to pick up the theme that your Pope has set for this year, a theme of mercy. Do what we have received mercy from what Christ has done for us on the cross. We are recipients of wonderful mercy. There was a gentleman who took his Rolls Royce to France for his holidays. And as he was driving around France and finding his way around France, his Rolls Royce broke down. He went to the local little garage person, and he couldn't fix such a magnificent engine as a Rolls Royce engine. And so he phoned up the manufacturers in Derby in England and said, my Rolls Royce is broken down, you need to help me out. And so they sent a mechanic over from Derby. He fixed it, and on he went on his holiday. He drove his Rolls Royce then back up through France and back into England. A few months later he thought, I never got a bill. I must phone up Rolls-Royce and see what's happened. And so he did. He phoned up Rolls-Royce and he spoke to one of the top engineers. And he said, sir, you sent the mechanic over all the way to France. He spent a few days there. He fixed my Rolls-Royce. It's going smoothly. Where is my bill? The engineer said back to him, sir, we have no record of a Rolls-Royce ever breaking down. Through what Christ has done for us on the cross, God has no record of us ever breaking down. There's no record of what things we have done that we're ashamed of. There's no record of any of our transgressions. We are the recipients of mercy. God's mercy can be and is our experience through the love of God. We are the recipients of mercy. There was an old lady who went to get her portrait taken. And she said to the artist, you will do justice to me, sir, won't you? He replied, it's not justice you need, it's mercy. And we have received mercy. But the challenge for us as a church is this. How will we show mercy Pope Francis, to quote him, said, "Today I ask you in the name of Christ and the Church, never tire of being merciful." I've had many lovely adventures in my year as president. It comes to an end in a few weeks' time. The highlight for me was to meet a group of 51 people. I met them in Belfast. The youngest was 8. The oldest was in his mid-50s. 8 families, 6 Muslim and 2 Christian. They were the refugees who came from the Lebanese refugee camps under the Syrian resettlement program that the British government has put in place. And I have to say, the Belfast people did it very well. But meeting that family, those families, was just a challenge. The challenge was this: how can we show mercy to people who are different than we are? The challenge, as Leslie, my wife, sat with little Mohammed and played hungry hippo with him, and he beat her every time. He had no English, and so Leslie taught him 1 to 10. He was like a little sponge. But Brian would take it off to meet another family, a lady in her full burqa, a lad of 18, a girl of 15, and a little lad about 12. They had a little bit of English, so we could talk about Lionel Messi and Ronaldo and Barcelona and Real Madrid. They'd been in a Lebanese refugee camp for 2 years, and so therefore their education had been stopped. They had learned little. He wanted to be a doctor, she wanted to be a nurse, and he wanted to play for Real Madrid. But Mom stood beside me. Her husband had been murdered just before they were taken and fled to the refugee camps. And there she was. And whenever I saw the embodiment of the word bewildered, it was in that lady's eyes. Of course she was bewildered. She only found out when she got on the plane that she was coming to Ireland. She only found out her new home was a piece of paper in front of her. It was an address that I knew, but she had no idea where it was at that place. She didn't understand about shopping or schooling or anything. It was lovely and it was good that those people have settled well in Belfast. They have joined the Muslim community, and those who are Christian have joined a local Presbyterian church and an Antiochian church in which they come from. To show mercy to those who are different from us. Zacchaeus understood that. He received mercy, and he went on to show mercy. He gave back all that he had stolen. It is lovely to reach out to those on the margins, to welcome a stranger, to welcome a person who is different. There were three men who went to war in the First World War, and we come to the song of commemoration, and hopefully we can do this as an Irish people and commemorate the song, because the two divisions came from Ulster and from Ireland. Three men went to war. Just before they went off to their appointment, one of the men was killed. And so they ran up to the priest's house and said, "Sir, sir, can we bury our comrade in your grave, in your graveyard?" And he said, "No, I'm sorry, that's consecrated ground. You can't. But what you can do is you can bury him just outside the walls of our graveyard." And they did that. They buried him. And off to war, the two remaining soldiers went. They survived, and they came back. And they thought, "Before we return to England, let us go and pay our last respects to our comrade." And so they did. They couldn't find his grave. There was nowhere to be found outside the grave walls, the graveyard walls. And so they went up to the priest's house and tapped on the priest's parochial house and said, "Sir, sir, what have you done with our comrade's grave?" He said, "Your visit troubled me greatly. I wasn't happy that I put your brother outside the graveyard walls, and And so last week I moved the walls of the graveyard, and now your brother is buried with the rest of us. I think that's a challenge for us as the church. Will we move the walls to allow those who are other to come and share with us and to show them mercy? One of my most challenging events happened a few years ago. It's a story I tell frequently. It's a story of me standing in a garage wanting to buy a bottle of Coke. And I noticed the girl who was going to serve me. She had the most gorgeous blue hair. She was about 17. And I sensed the Lord saying to me very clearly, "You've got to say to her, you love her blue hair." My first thought was, "Lord, I am 54, she is 17, and that is creepy." But I got to the front, and I said to her, "I hope you don't misunderstand me. I love your blue hair." She handed me my change and my bottle of Coke, and she said, "Never miss the pain that lies behind blue hair." I gave her a card and she phoned me twice. And I realised after the second conversation there was nothing that I as a man could deal with. And so nicely I asked a friend of mine to step in, and would she help her? And not long afterwards she said to me, the counsellor friend said to me, "Brian, there's a little less pain behind the blue hair." My point is this. It takes a bit of courage for a bald, fat, 54-year-old to say to a beautiful 17-year-old girl, "I like your blue hair." But do you see how I fitted into the chain of what God's Spirit was doing for that girl? Folks, as we as Christians, to show mercy to friends and to the alien, to the stranger, would we take a few risks? Because Christ took a big risk for us when he died on the cross. And so why shouldn't we do the same? To show some mercy and take some risks to help people along their journey in life. In the name of the Father, and the Son.